Thank you to Politics and Prose. This is a wonderful venue. Abby, thank you for having me here. It is a pleasure and an honor. So let me just get right into this book. I opened the book with this. One other acknowledgement I'd like to make is Sam Sachs is back here. Sam helped tremendously with this book. Did a lot of the research, a lot of the editing, some of the writing in it, filled in for me on the TV show tonight. Right. Right now, we're on the air, and it's Sam's face. There you go. And Kurt and Andrew and Nate are with us, who are our line producer and a senior producer and producer for the TV show. And Sasha's here from RT. Oh, there's Sasha. So and Luis from Brazilian television. I forget the. Thank you all. I always, they say it's dangerous to start thanking people because you always forget somebody. But I start the book with a story that I remember from when I was about 7 or 8 years old. And it always stuck with me. It's, just one of those kind of things that just always sticks with you. And my dad used to subscribe to John Campbell's book, Amazing Science Fiction. It was this little monthly science fiction magazine that actually had some of the most brilliant, I mean, this was back in the 50s, and in the late 50s, probably. I was 7 years old, it was 1958. And the luminaries of science fiction, Poul Anderson and Robert Silverberg and Frank Herbert and Jack Vance were writing for a penny a word for this magazine. And I wanted to find the story to put in the book, but I couldn't find a whole collection of, I wasn't sure which year it was, of like 3 years worth of amazing stories within my budget. So I just did it from memory. So here it is. Anyhow, in this story, this was, of course, before the 60s, before Jack Kennedy said we're going to send a man to the moon and bring him back. It was before there'd been any space exploration, and nobody had ever seen the backside of the moon. And so in the science fiction story, in the science fiction book, or short story, this group of astronauts have been blasted off from the Earth, and they're going around the backside of the moon, and they're going to see the backside of the moon and then come back and tell us all what it was, take pictures of it, whatever they can do. And nobody knows what's back there. I mean, could it be a crashed spaceship from an ancient civilization? Might it be, like Jules Verne, there's a jungle with dinosaurs? I mean, could it be, little green people? I mean, what is it? What could it be? And as they're coming around the backside of the moon, they say to Houston, to control, we've got to turn off the power to save the batteries, because they had vacuum tubes back in those days, and we're going to turn off the filaments because we're going to lose your signal anyway, because the moon is going to interfere with the radio waves. And so we'll catch you guys in a few hours when we come back around the other side of the moon. And they turn off the radios, and as they go around the backside of the moon, they're looking out the windows, and there's this moment of collective shock and horror. And then virtually a fistfight breaks out in the cockpit of the space capsule about, should we tell them? Or should we not? I mean, and if we do, and if we don't, what are we going to tell them? And it became this, because, the old roller coasters that they used to have back, in the 50s and what, that are made out of 2x4s. Nowadays they make them out of steel, but the old 2x4 roller coasters. Well, as they came around the backside of the moon, what they saw was that the entire backside of the moon was 2x4s, like scaffolding, holding up the canvas, which was the front of the moon. And so the backside of the moon was just this empty shell, and these 2x4s were holding up what we see every night, thinking, oh, that's the moon. The reason I wanted to use that story, other than the fact that I've just loved that story since I was 8 years old, is that I think it's the perfect metaphor for our economy right now. Our economy has been hollowed out. It looks like the old moon looked, right? It looks like the old economy. You drive down the street and you see, all these cars and houses. You say, well, look at all those houses. How can people be broke? They still have houses. What you don't see is that this one now is $50,000 underwater, and this one's $300,000 underwater, and that one's in foreclosure, and this one's, what used to be equity is now debt. You look at all the cars. People say, oh, look at all these new cars. People are driving all these cars. What you don't see is that 30 years ago, most of the cars that you saw on the road had some equity. People bought a car, and then 2 or 3 or 4 years later, they would sell it. And when they sold it, they'd get about half the cost of the car back toward the new car. They had equity in their car, just like they had equity in their houses. Now, these are all rented. They call it leasing. And it wasn't even a, it was considered a crazy idea in 1980 when Ronald Reagan came into office. To rent a car? Really? Seriously? Come on. You know, you buy a car. It's yours, you know. So, and in fact, one of the other stories that I remembered from my dissipated youth was from the 60s, in I believe it was 1966. And we actually did track this down. In fact, Sam put some yeoman's work in going through copy after copy of, I think we bought a year's worth of Time magazine or something like that, you know, digging through these things of trying to find. Time magazine back in, well, actually, let me set this up. The thing that makes profit for companies is productivity, right? People work and they make things, and making things produces profits. And the productivity of a worker is how much a person can make versus how much time they put in. And from the George Washington administration to the Ronald Reagan administration, for the first 200 years of the United States, more or less, as productivity increased, and there were some startling increases. You know, the Eli Whitney and the cotton gin in 1835, the beginning of the Industrial Revolution in the 1870s, really in a big way, the railroads in the 1850s. Every one of these steps along the way, we saw dramatic increases in productivity. But along with those increases in productivity came increases in wages. And if it wasn't an increase in wage, it was an increase in quality of life that was just as good as an increase in wage. The census of 1900 showed that the average wealth of the average American, the average income of the average American was $5,000 a year. People were fairly poor in 1900. But by that time, we had reached the point where the average work week was 60 hours. There had been this big move in the late 1800s for a 60-hour work week. It became a move for the 50-hour work week in the early 20th century, and then the 40-hour work week around and after World War II. So pay went up, the work week went down, people got more leisure time, because as productivity went up, the fruit of that productivity was given to the laborers as pay or as reduced hours. I mean, this was just how it always was. This was the contract. The American dream was really out of this. My father lived the American dream, you know, the American dream that literally Alexis de Tocqueville in 1838 or 1836, when he came to the United States and wrote Democracy in America, wrote about, which you can find for sale still in this bookstore, I'm sure. And that every person, and the American dream back then, the American dream now, was not to become Jeff Bezos or whoever the Facebook guy is, you know, hit the jackpot. That was not the American dream. The American dream was to live a good life, to have meaningful work, to have something left over for your retirement when you're finished, to be able to launch your children into the world, to be able to care for yourself and have health care when you need it, to be able to educate yourself and your children, to take a vacation every year. I mean, this was, and to have something when you die. My dad, when he was 17, World War II was just ending, although he didn't realize it, and so he volunteered to go fight in World War II, and about 3 or 4 weeks into basic training, they dropped the bombs in Japan, and that was the end of the war. So he spent the next 2 years in Japan as part of the occupation. He came back, and on the GI Bill, went to college. Here's a kid who had never gone to college. My mother's family's been in this country from the 1600s, but his father came to the United States in 1917 from Norway. I mean, he was a broke immigrant, a cabinet maker who was living up in upstate Michigan, making furniture out of wood. And my dad wanted to be a history professor. He wanted to get his PhD in history and teach history, and that was what he was going to do. And the government was paying him to do that. They were actually paying him to go to college. And that was the track that he was on until he met my mom, and they fell in love and got married. And then 13 months later, I came along. And at that point, Dad dropped out of college and got a job, and this is where the American Dream story starts. Dad ended up getting a job in a tool and die shop, Lansing Tool and Die in Lansing, Michigan, a union shop. Machinists Union. And by the time he died in 2006, he had long ago paid off his house, in which he had raised me and my three younger brothers. He had a pension that paid for him, and not only him, but rolled over to my mom, who lived another 4 years after my father did. He had had health care his entire life, right up until the day he died, and that health care rolled over to my mom. This was all part of the union deal. Right? He had Social Security in addition to that, that he was living on. I mean, life was good. My dad was a collector of books. My dad had 20,000 books in his basement. He was very proud of the fact that he had read, he claimed he'd read them all. I think he probably read half of them. My parents didn't watch TV. They would lay in bed and read for 2, 3, 4 hours every night. That was all they ever did. But that was the American dream. And somehow that got lost. Well, anyhow, back to my original point with Time magazine. So as productivity went up, wages always went up. And so Dad's American dream was much better than his father, which was better than my mother's grandfather, and on all the way back to the early days. And so the question that Time magazine was asking was, and this was in 1966, and it was a serious question. And it was just based on math. I mean, this was just simple math. This was not a great sociological question. Was, if productivity continues to increase, and we've got these computers now, with you know, put a pile of cards that are coded in Fortran in them, and out the other end comes an equation, and we've got robots starting to help make cars and things. If productivity continues to increase at the rate it simply has been increasing for the last 40 years, what will life be like 40 years from now? What will the year 2000 be for the average working American? What's it going to be if productivity follows wages? And here's what they came up with. I quote, "By 2000, the machines will be producing so much that everyone in the U.S. will, in effect, be independently wealthy. With government benefits, even non-working families will have, by one estimate, an annual income of $30,000 to $40,000. How to use leisure meaningfully will become the nation's major problem." By the way, $30,000 to $40,000 in 1966 dollars is $199,000 to $260,000 in today's dollars. Now, the fact of the matter is that if productivity has continued to increase since 1966 on a fairly linear scale. Wages flattened out starting in 1978, really started flattening out in 1980. Had wages kept up with productivity, those numbers would actually be accurate. The minimum wage right now would be over $22 an hour. That's the minimum wage. That's like teenagers starting at McDonald's if that had simply happened. So what happened in that gap that began in the 80s that had never before happened in the history of the United States? What happened with that gap? Why is it that for 32 years, wages have been flat, but productivity and profits have continued to increase? Why is it that corporations in America right now are more profitable than ever before in the history of the world, all the way back to the Roman Empire? Why is it that the wealthy in America are wealthier now than any time in the history of the world, all the way back to the Roman Empire? Why is it that the middle class in America is now so hollowed out that simple American dream that my dad had, which was not, you know, wildly Facebook ambitious, you know, it wasn't Silicon Valley, let's get rich. It was just, let's have that's beyond the reach of most people even getting out of college today. And we've got a lost generation. Kids in their 20s and 30s who are just being devastated by this economy. What happened? Why did it happen? And what does it mean for us right now? Well, those are the questions that we try to answer in the book. And over the next 30 minutes or so, I'm going to answer or share with you at least some insights in. And the story, in a very real way, begins. There's two stories. First of all, there's the story of what happened to the working people and what happened to the rich. We know that the top 1% have seen massive gains, 231%. You know, just since 2000. And of course, the average working person has seen a decline in their wages. But how have people kept up? How is it that they still even have their houses and their cars? Well, first of all, in the 80s, mom went to work. And then secondly, that wasn't enough. First of all, mom was only being paid 70% of what dad was, and in many cases, not even that. So then secondly, the families said, well, okay, to keep up, we've got to, we'll have to, you know, run up a little bit of debt. I remember the year 1976. I don't have my American Express card with me, so I can't pull it out and show you. But in 1976, I was 25 years old, and I was running a business in Michigan, and it was the first year that I had ever made more money in my life than my dad. I made, you know, we were doing really well. My partner, Terry O'Connor, and I had this little herbal tea company, and we made a lot of money that year. And I finally, and that was cool. My dad was proud of me. I was proud of me. But the thing that was most interesting was that I finally qualified for a credit card. In 1976, I finally got an American Express card. Now, I couldn't run a line of credit on it. You had to pay the thing off 100% at the end of every month. You remember, you know what I'm talking about. You know, but, you know, hey, it was a big deal. 25 years old, I got a credit card? Wow. Okay. So, well, that was 76. By the time we got into the 80s and into the 90s, it was pretty much everybody had a credit card, and now average credit card debt in the United States on a per person basis is between $7,000 and $9,000, depending on whose numbers you're looking at. On a per family basis, I've seen numbers as low as $12,000 and as high as $27,000. It's a lot of guesses, nobody's really sure, but it's substantial. So we wiped out our credit cards. And now my cat, who died 2 weeks ago, continues to get credit card applications. I mean, this is so then people turned their homes into ATMs. And they said, okay, you know, we've been making payments on the house here for 15 years. There's $100,000 worth of equity in the house. Why don't we take that out and we'll live on that? And especially as the boom went, the banksters were encouraging all this kind of stuff. And so we wiped out our homes. And then it was like, well, you know, let's sell the car and we'll just rent a car. We lost the equity in the car. And then finally, the most pernicious, I think, of all, was, okay, we've run out, my generation, the people who kind of have made it through this, we've run out of our home equity, we've run up our credit card equity, we've lost the equity in our car, we may have our possessions, but, you know, we've pretty much wiped out our retirement because we no longer have a pension, we have a 401k, and we're at the whims of the marketplace. But we can throw our kids into debt. Right. In other words, the deal that Louise and I had with our three kids, you know, thank God we got in the game early enough and we were successful early enough in life, was we'll pay for 4 years of college for each of you. And we were able to do that. But a lot of parents now can't. And so what's happened is, for the first time, again, in the history of the world, think about that for a minute. The first time in the history of the world, there's $1 trillion in student loan debt out there. $1 trillion. This is a generation that is more indebted than my father's generation when they came back from World War II had in assets. You know what they were hoping for? I mean, only the reverse. So this is like, you know, kind of the death of the American dream. So what brought this about? What brought this about? In 1951, there's a fellow by the name of Russell Kirk, who wrote a book called The Conservative Mind. And Russell Kirk represented, the Conservative Mind is still in print. In fact, I'm sure they sell it here in the bookstore. And it's a good read. This is the book that created the modern conservative movement. Is that Roger? Hey, Roger Hickey, great to see you. Ourfuture.org, another great organization. Russell Kirk started the modern conservative movement in many ways. And he animated, I mean, this is the book that I can't tell you how many times back in the years when I used to sit and watch Firing Line with my dad on the weekends, where William F. Buckley would refer to Russell Kirk. And Barry Goldwater would talk about Russell Kirk. And my dad would talk about Russell. And I read Russell Kirk. And in fact, I still remember quite vividly the first chapter of Russell Kirk's book, The Conservative Mind, is devoted to Sir Edmund Burke. Sir Edmund Burke was the British philosopher and you know, who Thomas Paine spent 2 weeks with on his way to the French Revolution and got so frankly pissed off at that he wrote an entire book as a rebuttal to Burke. His book was called The Rights of Man, and which is also available in the store and is a good read. But anyhow, Kirk is, in my mind, most famous for his comment about, you know, basically he was a conservative's conservative. In other words, society should move forward, but it should move forward slowly and gradually in measured steps that are recalibrated continuously. None of this rapid change stuff, right? That's basically the conservative philosophy in a nutshell, the non-toxic conservative philosophy, the literally my dad's conservative philosophy, my dad who died a conservative in 2006. That was that philosophy. And but Russell Kirk pushed it a little bit. I mean, given the times, he thought that people who did not own property and were not the upper class should not even be allowed to vote. In fact, one of his quotes was, it does me no harm if a man is allowed to engage in a profession as servile as that of hairdresser or tallow maker, candle maker, but it does society considerable violence if such a man is allowed to participate in governance. You know, so that is what Russell Kirk opens his book with, is a chapter on Sir Edmund Burke. And in the conservative mind, keep in mind, this was 1951, maybe 52. In the conservative mind, Kirk predicts that if the American middle class continues to grow at the rate it had been since the end of World War II, or really even since the mid-30s, if the American middle class gets wealthy enough, that it's going to cause enormous social instability. And from a conservative's point of view, that's not a good thing. Social change over time, fine. Social instability, bad. This, and by the way, this debate's been going on for a long time. Read the letters between Thomas Jefferson and John Adams. And John Adams was a conservative's conservative, moved step by step right down to the Alien Sedition Acts of 1798, you know, just trying to shut down any kind of, you know, don't talk back to me was basically his motto. He put 18 editors and newspaper editors in jail and shut down their newspapers. One of them, Benjamin Franklin Bach, the grandson of Benjamin Franklin, got put in prison by President John Adams for saying that Adams was old, toothless, querulous, and balding. That was his crime. For that, he went to prison. Jefferson left town the day that law was signed. He was so upset about it. So Jefferson thought there every year there should be a revolution. You know, in fact, there's a great quote from him about it. He said, "If this avenue of periodic revolution be shut to the call of sufferance, it will make itself heard through that of force, and we shall go on, as other nations are doing, in the endless cycle of oppression, rebellion, reformation, and oppression, rebellion, and reformation again and again and again, so on forever." But the conservatives, like Russell Kirk, thought, no, that's a bad thing. So Kirk predicted that if the middle class got big enough, it would be a dangerous thing for America because this country would become unstable. And we had just seen what happened in Russell Kirk's lifetime, what happened when countries got unstable. I don't know if he was old enough at the time but to have seen it, but he certainly knew about the Bolshevik Revolution, for example, the revolutions in Eastern Europe, the revolutions in South America, revolutions all around the world. Right? The old order was changing, and sometimes it changed for the better, and sometimes it changed for the worse. In fact, you know, while Thomas Paine thought that the French Revolution was the ultimate proof that he was right, his liberalism was right, Sir Edmund Burke thought the terrors and Maximilian Robespierre was the ultimate proof that the conservative worldview is right. And the fact of the matter is both of them, there was some truth to both of them. So anyhow, Kirk predicted this. Flash forward 1971. 21 years later, 20 years later. And now what you have is pretty much what Kirk predicted on the social level. You had African Americans who, throughout the 60s, became very visible and got really significant legislation passed, the Voting Rights Act, the Civil Rights Act, and others. And still, it wasn't fast enough. You had the cities in flames. You had cities in flames in the United States. You had gays, 1969 Stonewall riots. You had gays saying, hey, what about us? We're here too. We're part of the human family. You had women. The birth control pill had been legal for 10 years at that point. You had a women's movement. 1971, Ms. Magazine was published. Gloria Steinem. You had women who were burning their bras in public and demanding equal pay in the workplace and just generally raising hell. You had young people getting high. You had young people saying, hell no, I'm not going to go off to that war. I'm not going to fight your crazy war, they were saying. We had basically every sector of America that wasn't old, wealthy, and white was in revolt. You even had the middle class in revolt. We were having strikes. My dad's union was striking in the 70s. You had, you know, the middle class white guys in Central Michigan were striking. So right across the board, the conservatives were looking at this and going, you know, that Russell Kirk guy, he was dead on, spot on right. These people have too much money. This middle class is doing too well. They are too safe. Ronald Reagan looked at this. He was governor of California. He said, why should I pay the college tuition of some kid who's just going to attack me? They actually called them brats, was Reagan's term, and put an end to free tuition at the University of California. A little bit later than that, but the point. So 1971, a fellow, a fairly well-intentioned fellow, I think. Oh, this is, by the way, that's the social half. Social upheaval was going on. And so the liberals loved it. I remember 71. I remember the late 60s. I thought of it as a great time. You know, I quote in here from the Wikipedia entry, which was clearly written by a conservative, about how, you know, the late 60s was this time of this dystopian time, you know, like everybody was a meth head or something, and everybody was, you know, and it was just, you know, wild sex in the streets and stuff, you know. I remember it as being just a really, really wonderful time, and it was a time of great social change, and it was a great time of learning and all those kind of things. But, you know, the conservatives were looking at it going, no, this is not how change should happen in America, socially. Economically, it was even more severe. Economically, the barons of industry had basically run this country from its founding. I mean, they really became the barons during Reconstruction, during the early Industrial Revolution. And by the 1970s, they were largely apolitical, these large corporations that ran and controlled so much of America. But they had a real serious problem. In 1962, Rachel Carlson published Silent Spring and said, if we keep spraying DDT, and I remember as a little kid going out, you know, my parents saying, don't go out until in the morning. You see the DDT on the car because they were spraying for mosquitoes in Lansing, Michigan. She said this DDT stuff, it might not be killing the people, but what it's doing is it's causing the shells of the eggs on the birds not to be formed well enough, and so, you know, the hatchlings are not hatching, and it's killing the insects. And so one day we're going to have a silent spring. We're going to wake up one spring and the trees will blossom, but you're not going to hear the birds and you're not going to hear the bees. And that started an environmental movement that had Monsanto and Dow Chemical and a dozen other companies just running for the hills. And then 3 years later, 1965, Ralph Nader published Unsafe at Any Speed. And suddenly Americans discovered that General Motors and Ford and these other auto companies were sitting around going, okay, the average life of a person, if they sue us, the one out of three who actually does, is going to cost us $72,000. But if we don't put this $3 bolt in, which will prevent, you know, 7,000 deaths, we'll make a profit equal to 9,000 people dying. And so let's not put the bolt in because it's more profit, you know, the whole cost-benefit equation. And it really, really upset Americans. And so you had, as a consequence of Ralph Nader's Unsafe at Any Speed, you had a serious consumer movement that was coming along. And even, you know, there used to be a time when the old joke was, and those of you of my age know exactly what I'm talking about, where the old joke was among business people, you know it's a bad day when you wake up in the morning and the 60 Minutes crew is on your doorstep, right? They don't say that anymore, of course, now, because it's just a fluff show. But it used to, you know, there was the serious investigative journalism going on. You know, you had Jack Anderson out there, you know, raking muck, right? People were, you know, the secrets of America's business were being exposed. So 1971, this very thoughtful guy who when we started doing the research on this book, I was convinced was probably one of the great villains of history. And I now think probably was a very well-intentioned fellow who, if he was still alive, would look back and say, I can't believe that this happened. you know, that it has worked out this way. But it did happen. And that was Lewis Powell. And Lewis Powell was a soft-spoken, genteel Virginian lawyer. His biggest clients were the tobacco companies, but he also represented the rich and famous and powerful. And Lewis Powell wrote a memo to one of his next-door neighbors and close friends, Eugene Sindor, who is the president of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. And in it, he said, "We are under assault." I mean, I literally used that phrase, "We're under assault. And we need to stop being apolitical. We need to respond. We need to do something about this. Because if we don't, you know, America, first of all, is falling apart socially. And on top of that, the business infrastructure which supports this nation is under assault." These guys really were thinking of Rachel Carlson and Ralph Nader as the modern day equivalents of Trotsky and you know, whatever his name was. Lenin came later, but you know, the guy who was with Molotov. In any case. So he said, you know, we've got to, and then he goes through the list. He said, you know, it shouldn't be Ralph Nader's picture on the front page of Life magazine. It should be the president of General Motors. We need to be telling our stories, not just their stories. We need to get control of the media. And to get control of the media, not only should we be engaging in business activities like buying media, but we should, more importantly, be starting think tanks that produce media papers so that our story gets told. And out of this memo that Lewis Powell wrote to his neighbor, Eugene Sindor, came the Heritage Foundation, the Charles Koch Foundation, which we today know of as the Cato Institute, and a number of other, the American Legislative Exchange Council and others. If they didn't come directly from it, they certainly came from the spirit of it. We have to take control of the media, number one. Number two, we need to take control of the court system. Out of this came the creation of the Federalist Society. Let's put a conservative in every law school. Let's put a conservative in every law classroom. Let's make sure that the textbooks reflect a conservative worldview. We have to get control of our schools. Let's start funding the seats in our schools. Let's start funding the teachers. You know, when Ronald Reagan came into office in 1980, you could go to school in this country without student debt. Student debt in, you know, I didn't complete college, but when I went to college in 1969 and 1970, I worked my way through college, through what little of it I did, through Lansing Community College and Michigan State University, working as a waiter at Bob's Big Boy and dishwasher. And for one day I was a waiter. The one day that all the girls went on strike, and boy, have I over-tipped ever since then. But anyhow, and you know, changing tires at the Exxon station and working as a minimum wage weekend DJ at the local country western station, WITL, AM and FM, Lansing, Michigan. And you could do that. You could pay your way through college doing that back then, because 80% of the cost of tuition was paid for by state, federal, local governments, or the schools themselves. 80%. Actually, it's a little more than 80%. Today, it's reversed. Less than 80% is paid for, now more than 80%, is paid for by the individual students. And about 20% is paid for by everybody else. And so everybody talks about this inflation that we've seen in tuitions. We haven't really seen an inflation in tuitions. What we've seen is a fundamental realignment of who pays for what. It used to be that the middle class was viewed as the infrastructure, the intellectual infrastructure of the United States. Our students were our intellectual infrastructure. So we invested in that. There was a social consensus about this. I mean, it went back to Abraham Lincoln. He created the land-grant colleges. He created over 50 colleges where he took a large enough chunk of land that a college could actually work that land, whether it be a farm or a forest or whatever, and make enough money that all the students could go to school for free. And this was not a new tradition. Thomas Jefferson, the thing that he was most proud of was, you know, on his tombstone, he wrote his own tombstone, was not that he was president of the United States for 8 years. I mean, he was proud of the fact that he wrote the Virginia Declaration of Independence or of Religious Freedom, and he was proud of the fact that he wrote the Declaration of Independence. But the third thing that's on his tombstone, that he founded the University of Virginia, which was the first free college in the United States. Anybody who could qualify academically could go to college there for free. This is a tradition that has always been part of America until the last 32 years. So anyhow, let's get control of our schools. And so now we find that billionaires and very conservative foundations are endowing schools, are requiring particular types of teachers, particular types of curriculum. You must read Ayn Rand or whatever. You know, all this kind of stuff is happening. So that happened. Trying to remember the rest of the list of the things that he said that we need to get. Anyhow, it's a bunch of them. I should have made a longer list. But so as this happened, and you know, we need to figure out, basically, we need to deregulate business, get business out of the business of, or get government out of the business of business. Let me pause for a moment and just step into the Wayback Machine. One of the premises of the book is one that's not unique to me. I was first exposed to it by Strauss and Howe in their book, The Fourth Turning, but they acknowledge others, and that's the idea of multi-generational cycles. And I would describe it a little different than they did. What I would say is what happens is that we make a terrible mistake, and then we learn from it, and then for about 60 years we remember that lesson, and then we forget. And for 20 years, we get really stupid, and then we make that terrible mistake all over again, and then we learn from it. Okay. Give point in case. In the election of 1920, Warren Harding ran for president on two basic platforms. One was that he was going to cut the top income tax from 95% down to 25%, 91% down to 25%. And the second was that he was going to privatize government functions, and he was going to stop regulating businesses. His slogan, his presidential slogan, was more business in government, less government in business. He was right up front about it. And he won. And he did it in 1921. Now, what happens when you drop that top tax rate from 95% or 91% down to 25%? Let me back up to another story that I started telling you earlier. 1976. I was having a very good year. I got my American Express card. In 1976, or maybe it was 1977, pretty sure it was 76, Terry and I, my partner and I, our CPA, we'd get together with him every 3 months, and he sat us down and he said, "You guys are taking too much money out of this company." I'm like, "What are you talking about? I just bought a brand new Volvo." You know, it's like, you know, we're having a good time here. And he's like, "No," he said, "you're starting, you know, at that point in time, the top income tax rate was, I mean, this was just after LBJ had tightened up the top, you know, so the top income tax was 74%. And he said, you know, you're paying over 40% in income taxes, and you're going to be pushing 50% this year, and that's a lot of money to be giving the federal government. He said, you can take that money, but just do it a different way. Put the money back into the business, develop some new products, hire some new people, expand your advertising and marketing, and then wait a year or two as the business grows, and then sell it and take that money as capital gains. You still get the money, the business does better, your employees do better, and everybody's happy." And I thought, that's a pretty cool idea, and that's what we did ultimately. And in fact, Terry and I sold that business to our employees in 1978. Didn't work out quite as well as we had hoped. We were in the herbal tea business, and Mo Siegel of Celestial Seasonings ate their lunch while we were gone. But in any case, that conversation was happening all over America. People, high net worth individuals, and that's about as, you know, close to that as I'd gotten, were being told, keep the money in. You know, the average CEO is making 30 times what their workers were making. I mean, at the high end, CEOs. And we were making nothing close to that. And it was because of that top tax rate. So what happens when that top tax rate of 74% gets dropped down to 20, well, Reagan dropped it to 28%. Harding dropped it to 25%. What happens? Immediately, all kinds of hot money starts flowing into people's hands, right? Instead of reinvesting in their business, instead of investing in their employees, instead of investing in new products, instead of building new factories and plants, they go, "Hey, I got some cash and I can gamble with it. Where can I get the best return on my investment? And I don't care if I lose half of it, because hell, I wouldn't have even had it if it wasn't for the tax cut. And so, oh, derivatives? Sure, let's try that." Right? And that's what happened. And that's what happened in 1921. It kicked off the Roaring Twenties. and you had a real estate explosion to the point where real estate property values in some parts of this country were doubling every month. And you had a stock market explosion where the stock market went from, as I recall, around 60 to around 360. I mean, just huge explosion in the stock market. And that bubble burst in 1929. And so, you know, it took us 3 years of pain to figure out, oh, so that's what happened. The banksters robbed us blind. And maybe that regulation was a good thing. And when FDR raised that top tax rate back up to 91%, pretty much nobody protested because people got it. You know, this is actually a good thing. And let's re-regulate some of these banks. In fact, let's put Glass-Steagall into effect. The United States has never, from the George Washington administration to the FDR administration, had never gone more than 15 years without a major banking panic. From 1935 until 2008, not one. So, flash forward to now you've got the conservatives have created this infrastructure, this belief system that deregulation is a good thing, that government is a bad thing, as a defensive mode, as an attempt. I would say this is like, you know, the collision of good intentions on both sides, really. Between conservatives and liberals, not genuine villains here. But what stepped into this gap were the predators. The predators were able to go to say, oh, we can use this, just like they did in the 20s. And so you had Phil Graham. Well, let me get to Phil in just a second. You had Ken Lay and Enron. And Ken's, you know, got 800 shell companies or something like that. He's got all these phony baloney companies that, you know, where he's hiding his losses so that he can keep his profits, and a couple of companies where he can skim big dividends off the top. And Ken wanted to be able to speculate in energy derivatives, which was illegal at that time. It was regulated by the federal government. You could do commodity trades, but only in real commodities. It was, and you had to be real counterparties and stuff. You know, it was to protect so that farmers and bakers basically could work things out, so that oil companies and airlines could have some price stability. That's why we had a commodities market. Ken Lay wanted with Enron. He wanted to play in this market, so he started lobbying Wendy Graham, Phil's wife, who was the president, who was the head of the Federal Commodity Futures Commodity Futures Regulation Agency, I'm forgetting the name of it. And she deregulated energy and said, fine, have fun, Enron. And a couple months later, she left that job and joined the board of Enron. Well, this wasn't quite enough for Ken Lay. He now he could play with this stuff, but he had the banks on his back, and he wanted to be able to own a bank. And he wanted, and not just a bank. At that point in time, in 1997, there was a law that said that a gambling bank like Merrill Lynch, you know, a commercial investment bank, could not issue checkbooks. And a checkbook bank, you know, like your basic Wells Fargo, could not gamble with your money. You had to choose. You had to either be a commercial bank or a gambling or an investment bank, but you couldn't have both. But Ken Lay wanted to be able to move his money around and hide it wherever he wanted and then gamble with it at the same time. And so Phil Graham introduces in 1999 and 2000 two pieces of legislation, Graham-Leach-Bliley, which ends Glass-Steagall, which says, you know, basically anybody, even Ken Lay, can buy a bank, and banks can gamble with their investors' money, and the Commodity Futures Modernization Act, which says that you can bet on things through unregulated markets. It doesn't have to go through the Chicago Board of Trade, where we make sure that there's actually pork bellies that are being traded and there's actually people who are going to take possession of them because they run restaurants where they sell bacon, you know, that kind of thing. You can just make things up and trade them. And so what happened after these two pieces of legislation, first of all, Ken Lay was in heaven, and we can speculate about where he is now, but it used to be that let's say you were bakers and I'm a farmer, a wheat farmer, and I'd make a bet, you know, when am I going to sell you the wheat, what, like that. We'd work this out. But there had to be an actual time and an actual deal. And I'm going to wrap this up in about 5 minutes. I know it's getting kind of warm in here. And we could buy insurance on that bet, but that was pretty much it. And companies like AIG specialized in selling insurance on those bets. But once the commodities were deregulated, you could bet on anything. As long as there was some underlying product that had value from which that bet derived some semblance of value, thus the word derivative. So you could bet on our wheat deal, or say we had $1 million wheat deal, we could put a $10 million insurance policy on it, and then we could put a $100 million bet on that, whether that's going to go bad. In fact, on each side we could bet. And then we could bet $1 billion on the $100 million, and we could bet $10 billion on the, you know, and we just keep going, making bets on bets on bets. And the easiest thing to do this with was mortgages, because you can't see them. You know, with pork bellies, you can, hey, there they are physically. Oh, there's grain in that silo, you know. But with mortgages, nobody knows. It's all magic money in the bankster's balance sheets. Nobody knows. So what happened was that, and here's some numbers, and this is why I'm telling you that the crash of 2008, we're still in the middle of. And until we fix some of these structural things that I've been talking about tonight, it's we're just on the edge of tipping over again. And I know that the Obama administration right now, or I believe that the Obama administration is doing the exact same thing that the Bush administration did, which is not, you know, evil politics or anything, it's just totally predictable, which is try not to have this happen while we're in office, right? Try to hold it off until November of 2016, just like Bush tried to hold it off until November of 2008. Bush was not successful. Obama's got a double whammy, though. He's got an entire political party trying to bring this about as soon as they can. And Bush didn't. The Democrats were not trying to crash the economy. So anyhow, some numbers. The GDP of the United States is $15 trillion. This is all economic activity in the United States, all buying and selling, everything. The GDP of the entire planet is $65 trillion. The entire planet. Okay. Before Ken Lay came along, there were basically no derivatives. I mean, you had a couple billion dollars in the derivatives market, but it was no big deal. And a lot of it was a regulated market. It was a fairly transparent market. In the 8 years from 2000, when this got legalized, until 2008, when it fell apart, the market in derivatives, in bets on bets on bets on bets on bets, went from zero to, according to the Bank of International Settlements, $800 trillion. The GDP of the whole planet is $65 trillion. This is total funny money. And every time one of these banksters makes a $100 trillion bet, they skim $1 billion in salary off the top. And so this is an economy that's built on nothing. Now, according to various articles I've seen in the Financial Times, that dropped down to around $500 trillion during the crash, but it's back up around $700 trillion now. So we've got a series of fundamentals that we need to be addressing. This door that was opened by the deregulation and the attempts by conservatives to push back against the Ralph Naders of the world has been stepped into by predators like Ken Lay and banksters on Wall Street, and we need to do something about it. Elizabeth Warren is probably the most articulate spokesperson for that, Bernie Sanders as well. And you know, I think ultimately it's all going to come down to us. The good news is that when crashes happen, political opportunities open up. It's like there's a crack in reality, to paraphrase Leonard Cohen. And in that light, we can step forward and do something. Every time we've had a crash in the United States, it's been followed by major forward progressive motion. The crash of 1935 led to unionization and all the benefits of the New Deal. The crash of 1897 led to the 17th Amendment, the 19th Amendment, the enfranchisement of women, and the direct election of the Senate. The crash of 1857 led to the end of slavery. The crash of 1770 led right to the creation of the United States. Every one of these has produced a positive outcome on the back end when people were ready for it. And that's the good news, I think, in this, that the ground is being sowed. People are waking up. People are ready. It's just going to take a certain political momentum, a certain mass. I hope it's not a horrible crash that brings it about. But this slow motion train wreck that we have right now has to resolve itself one way or another, and I think it will. So the bottom line, the net of all of this, is that it all comes back to this really simple thing, and that is that we need to be awake and aware of what's going on. Tell everybody you know about it. Get ready for it in whatever way you personally and professionally can, and pass it along. Tag You're It. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
And I think it's great, and I agree with you. What do you do about people like your father, who now belong to the Tea Party? They're conservative, they're white, they're older, they had good jobs, union jobs. Now, I understand why the Koch brothers do what they do, but why do people like your father support them?
Right. Because they're watching Fox News, because they're believing the propaganda. There is the interests of the billionaire class are very, very well served by the political rhetoric that comes out of right-wing talk radio and right-wing television. And my father was not a Rush Limbaugh conservative. He was a Dwight Eisenhower conservative. And Dwight Eisenhower in 1956 ran on a platform of, I doubled the number of people in unions and we've expanded Social Security. That's what used to be called a conservative. But in any case, mm-hmm. I understand your point perfectly. And I just don't want my dad's memory totally sullied. Thank you. I think that what we have to do is, and I try to model this, you know, 3 hours a day on radio and an hour every night on television, 5 days a week, by debating conservatives, is we all have, you know, that crazy guy, you know, nephew or brother-in-law or uncle or whatever who comes to Thanksgiving dinner or Christmas dinner or Hanukkah or whatever it may be. We need to learn how to have these conversations and help wake them up and have them ask some really simple questions like, how does it really benefit me that Rush Limbaugh makes $400 million a year or makes $400 million and pays less in taxes? Or how does it benefit me that Mitt Romney can pay a carried interest tax rate instead of a normal one, and so he pays maximum 14%? How did, you know, stuff like that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Someone on that side?
Oh. Question. Yes, sir.
Yes. Is this on?
Yes.
If someone like Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren don't win the Democratic nomination, then should we be working towards a third party?
No. The question was, if somebody like Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren are not the nominees for the Democratic Party, should we be working toward a third party? And my personal answer is no, for two reasons. One, we have, whether we like it or not, and this was something James Madison realized in 1788 after he had written or helped write the Constitution, and while they were in the middle of trying to sell the damn thing, and it had not yet been ratified. And you can read it in Federalist Number 10, as it was a sales pitch, realized that he had basically created a two-party system with first-past-the-post, winner-take-all elections. It wasn't until 1861 that John Stuart Mill invented proportional representation, where, you know, if your party gets 12% of the votes, you get 12% of the seats in Parliament. So with first-past-the-post, winner-take-all elections, the kinds that we have here in the United States, you are inevitably going to have a two-party system, and third-party persons are always, or historically have always, or almost always, hurt the person closest to them. And you can take that all the way back to Teddy Roosevelt's election. You can take it back to the Whigs. So, A, I wouldn't do that. B, what I would do and what I think needs to be done, and I think it's so great that Bernie has said, you know, if nobody's talking to talk about these serious issues of the middle class, then I'll run for president. And I think you need to take him seriously on that. And he's an independent. He's not even a Democrat. Is that we have this myth in the United States that the man makes the times. And I say that not in a purely sexist sense, because every president we've ever had has been male. Hopefully that will change one day soon. But we have this notion that the man makes the times rather than that the times makes the man. And I would say that's not the case. Nowhere in the Constitution does it say, does the word leader appear. Nowhere. Nowhere in the Federalist Papers, nowhere. It's all representatives. The way politics works is when a politician notices a big enough parade going down the street, they will jump out in front of that parade with their own flag and say, this is my parade. And you want an example of that? Look at all these Republicans who all of a sudden became Tea Partiers. They saw a parade, they jumped in front of it, and they said, this is my parade. So if we want to see progressive change in the United States, we have to build the parade. We have to become the parade. And that's an inside-outside strategy. It means showing up at the Democratic Party or the Republican Party or the Green or whatever it may be, your proclivity, and saying, I want to volunteer and become a precinct committee person. And it means working the outside strategy, joining Move to Amend or Progressive Democrats of America or Drinking Liberally or whatever your thing may be. You know, there's lots and lots of groups out there.
My brother's a lifelong subscriber to National Review. We had a fine Thanksgiving together while I was up in Syracuse, New York. We're a Catholic family that's been fighting all the social issues for 30 years, and we're still talking to each other. He thinks they're painting themselves into a corner on a lot of these things. What do you think?
I think he's right. I think that the Tea Party movement and the and Roger Thiel, hey, Roger, the fellow author, the Tea Party movement and the Occupy movement are two sides of the same coin, in my opinion. And by the Tea Party movement, I'm not talking about the $300,000 buses that the Koch brothers bring in. I'm talking about the actual people who show up on the ground and think they're doing the right thing. There is a populist rage in America. People know they've been ripped off. They don't know why. They don't know how. And that's why I wrote this book.
They don't think stimulus worked for them.
Yeah. Yeah, well, the stimulus didn't work for them because it went to the banksters, and people are waking up to that, and we just need to help that waking up process. Yes, sir.
Hi. I'm wondering, given some of the successes that people like Ron Paul had and his son Rand Paul have,
right,
in the idea of non-intervention, you saw your interview with Ron Paul, mm-hmm, on your show.
Yeah.
One of my fears is, and I'm wondering if you share this fear, maybe not in 2016, but in the not too distant future, that a libertarian that is essentially hands off on reproductive issues, mm-hmm, someone who I would say is more consistent.
Actually, both Rand and Ron Paul are rabidly anti-abortion.
Right.
Anti-woman.
So I'm saying, so my wrinkle is, supposing there's a libertarian candidate, mm-hmm, who is more consistent.
Mm-hmm. Who's actually a libertarian.
Who's right, on the issue of reproductive choice. And as someone who we might align with as progressives on civil liberties, international affairs, but when it comes to the safety net and when it comes to putting some kind of limits on corporations, watch out. My fear is that in time, and I don't know enough about the polling, I hear little bits, that's something to worry about, a truly consistent libertarian, I don't care which party, but that person might be.
I am very concerned about the libertarian movement in the United States. Keep in mind, I believe it was Charles, it might have been David, but I'm pretty sure it was Charles Koch ran for president on the libertarian ticket back in 1980, I think it was, whatever the year was, back in the late 70s. A lot of this is being funded by them. Libertarians, I've always described libertarians as Republicans who want to smoke dope and get laid. You know, they want to decriminalize pot and decriminalize prostitution. But otherwise, they're Republicans, so I think that we need to be puncturing their bubbles and pointing out the numerous internal fallacies in libertarian theology. And it's a theology; it's never a philosophy. It is not a philosophy that has ever been tested anywhere in the world. And the closest we got to it was the Chicago School stuff that was inflicted in Chile by Pinochet when he brought in the Chicago School boys, and look at the damage that they did. Look at the incredible damage that they did and the people who died. So it has never succeeded anywhere, and it's antithetical to American values. We're a communitarian country. We're not Davy Crockett. You know, Davy Crockett needed a community too. So, yes.
All right, I think we are going to wrap it up there. Thank you so much.
Thank you.